Judges of the United States Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit. Oyez, oyez. All persons having business with the Honorable United States Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit are admonished to draw near and give their attention, for this court is now in session. God save the United States and this Honorable Court. Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Call our first case of the day, Brian Schmiegel versus Miroslav Ushal.
A real economy operation.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. My name is William Rogel, R-O-G-E-L. I represent the plaintiff and appellant in this matter, Brian Schmiegel. I'd like at this time to request 3 minutes of rebuttal.
That's granted.
Thank you, Your Honor. My client, Mr. Schmiegel, brought a meritorious medical malpractice action against Dr. Ushal, arising from an improperly placed lap band in a surgical procedure.
And no certificate of merit was filed with the complaint, is that correct?
That is correct, Your Honor.
Are you contending that you substantially complied with the rule?
I am contending that, Your Honor, yes.
How so?
I believe the key to the notion of substantial compliance is in the word substance. That is, the substance of the certificate of merit requirement is not the actual documentary certificate of merit, which is really an exercise in box checking, assuming the prerequisites are met.
Well, it has to be, because the Pennsylvania Supreme Court in the Walmer case, even though the equivalent of a certificate had been served on the other party in discovery, the fact that there was no certificate filed with the complaint was the key to the case. So you filed absolutely nothing and served absolutely nothing on the defendant, did you?
It is true that nothing was filed, at least not within the 60-day time period.
Right.
There is, of course, the second issue out there, which I will get to, assuming Your Honor has time for it later.
We'll have time.
Right.
Let's assume everything that Judge Rendell's questions have suggested and include are true. Why is it necessary for us to get to substantial compliance here? I mean, what we do know is that post-Wilmer, we have Ligon Redding. We know that the COM is substantive law as far as that goes, right?
Correct, Your Honor.
Now, I want to make sure I'm understanding your position here and the position that you did raise in the district court. You are contending, are you not, that the new, relatively, 2008 notice requirement is likewise substantive, as we're required to make it substantive law for our purposes. Is that right?
That is our position, yes.
All right. If that's the case, then the question initially becomes, was there compliance with the notice provision, which per your position is now substantive? Not whether there's substantial compliance. We wouldn't get to substantial compliance, would we?
That's certainly true.
The only way we get to substantial compliance per your position would be there's notice, and then counsel really, really is dumb and doesn't comply the second time around, and then you've got the substantial compliance.
That's correct. That's our understanding as well.
I just want to make sure I understood your
question. Is there a conflict between the Pennsylvania rules and the federal rules?
Not with respect to Rule 1042.6.
No, but you are proposing a change in the rules. According to your brief on pages, you propose changes to the federal rule, correct? That would give you an opportunity to file your COM. Is that correct?
No, I don't propose any change in the federal rules at all.
You don't?
I do not.
You think
Rule
12 is simply the proxy here, really, for the notice requirement under state law, isn't it?
Well, so Rule 12, Your Honor, has been found to be the analogous procedure to filing
by
the precipice by prior courts.
By district courts?
By district courts.
All right. But they're district courts. And, in fact, that's one of the reasons we're here, and one of the reasons we're here for argument, because we've got a number of district court decisions out there, and there are a number of different ways of looking at this within the Third Circuit, right?
That's right, Your Honor.
In the mind run of cases, i.e., where the statute of limitations has not run, where service was effected promptly as compared to waiting 47 days, there would be no difference in the impact of the federal rule versus the Pennsylvania rule, would there?
There might be some trivial impacts here and there, Your Honor, but no, certainly the expiration of the statute of limitations means that the dismissal without prejudice that otherwise would be easily remedied can't be remedied in this case.
So isn't this a situation where you chose to file in federal court, you need to know the rules, and the only rule we have is the substantive 60-day rule. That's the only one we have adopted. And you have to file within the statute. I mean, you waited almost 2 years, and you have to serve. So how, in this instance, can we say, we have a case called Nuveen recently decided on this very issue, and we were not willing to use New Jersey procedural rules because we said you chose to file in federal court, and attorneys are supposed to know the rules. So why should we, in effect, change a federal rule of civil procedure? That's really what you're asking us to do. You're asking us to, there is a federal rule of civil procedure that calls for a dismissal for failure to state a claim, and that is what would apply here. And you want us to change it for your unique situation where you yourself brought about this problem.
Your Honor, first of all, our position is certainly not, and it might read differently if it were a situation where we did not know the rule. I don't want to go back into the substantial compliance stuff, but this is a situation where we knew the rule and through inadvertence failed to file the certificate anyway. That notwithstanding, I just state again, I don't believe we're militating for or require any change of any federal rule.
Why doesn't Ligon Redding drive this whole thing for you?
It does, Your Honor.
I mean, why at most... Aren't you simply asking for an extension of Ligon Redding at most?
That's right. When Ligon Redding was decided, it was limited only to the applicability of Section 1042.3. This Court has never faced...
It was decided with respect to a filing that were applicable under the old regime prior to the 2008 rules, right?
That is my understanding, yes.
Yeah. Well, in fact, my recollection of the facts, procedural facts, are that the pivotal event here, that was Ligon Redding with a pro se filing, if I recall, and I think that event occurred in January of 2008, and the rule change didn't occur until June of 2008.
Correct.
Doesn't Hannah, the Supreme Court's opinion of Hannah, really affect what happens here? Because in Hannah, the Supreme Court said there's a fundamental flaw. The assumption that the rule of Erie constitutes the appropriate test of the validity and therefore the applicability of a federal rule of civil procedure. The Erie rule has never been invoked to void a federal rule. Didn't the Supreme Court say in Hannah that Erie, which would be, a substantive test, substantive versus procedural, you don't go to Erie when it's a federal rule? Specifically, though the choice of federal or state rule will at this point have a marked effect upon the outcome of the litigation, the difference between the two rules would be of scant, if any, relevance to the choice of forum. So that would be an Erie analysis. But is there a case that says that we can void a federal rule when there's a state rule?
No, there's not. But, Your Honor, we're not asking the court to void Rule 12. We're not saying it's inappropriate.
What specifically are you asking us to do? What do you want us to say?
What we're asking this court to say, Your Honor, is that Rule 1042.6 is itself a substantive rule.
But how would that operate in our motion to dismiss? You're going to displace Rule 12. What will the federal rule be in Pennsylvania regarding this COM file?
The federal rule will be unchanged. What we're urging, Your Honor, is...
But it doesn't work. They can't work together.
Just like right now, if a Rule 12 motion is filed, one of the answers available to a plaintiff who, for example, believes his particular case doesn't require a certificate of merit is to file an answer and demonstrate to the court that the rule doesn't apply in the first place, at which point the motion to dismiss is denied. What we're urging is that the other portion of the parties protected by the new rule of Pennsylvania procedure, similarly have the ability, once a motion to dismiss is filed within 30 days.
To do something procedural, to do something that is covered by a federal rule, correct?
All we're asking for, Your Honor, is the ability within 30 days to file a certificate of merit, whereupon the motion to dismiss should be denied.
There is a provision in the Pennsylvania rule that says if a certificate of merit has been filed after a notice has been sent, then you can't null pros a case. You're asking for us to incorporate that into the federal rules, are you not?
Well, the Rule 1042.6 part of it, yes, Your Honor, because it's substantive
but
rule.
But it's not there. It's not in the Pennsylvania rule. It's not in the federal rules.
Of course, neither was 1042.3.
Correct. The certificate of merit is entirely a creature of state rule in the first place.
The whole point is that in Pennsylvania, in order to put this procedure in, they adopted a rule with comment and notice. We don't make rules. We don't adopt federal rules.
Isn't your argument that we in a sense crossed this bridge already with Leon Redding? That is, when we took 104.2.3, the remedy of dismissal is not part of 104.2.3. That remedy is something that is embodied in 0.6 and 0.7. And 0.7 includes a number of conditions when dismissal is appropriate. It's a conditional remedy with certain conditions that are specified in 104.2.7.
That's correct, Your Honor. And our contention in part is for the court to deem substantive and bring over part of the certificate of merit requirement while leaving that other part regarding notice behind puts our client in a different position in federal court than state court. So it's an outcome determinative distinction. It's why it has to apply in federal court.
You're looking
just
at this
as it does in the
as
state.
The parameters of the very requirement.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question, Your Honor.
You are asking us to look at this as the parameters. Here are the contours of the COM requirement and the attendant remedy of dismissal if you don't comply.
That's correct. The Rule 12 motion has to be because there isn't a non-pros procedure.
Saying it's the closest analog that we have.
And if we're
and 10 and Ligon Redding did discuss 1042.6, but it was the old 1042.6. Ligon Redding discussed not only a COM, it discussed the prospect of dismissal as well. So what we have right now is a substantive jurisprudence that has adopted some of the COM regime of Pennsylvania, but not all of it. Right?
That's exactly correct, Your Honor. And our point
let me ask you one last question and I'll shut up. I'm assuming this is a question everybody can agree on. Judge Schwab nowhere discussed current Rule 1042.6, did he?
That's correct.
I mean, he discussed Womer, he discussed the old regime, but nothing post-2008. Amendments.
That is accurate.
Do you see any distinction between the issue in Ligon Redding, which was if you file in Pennsylvania, you have to do something, i.e. file a certificate of merit, whereas in federal court, you don't have to do that. In other words, you could be thrown out in Pennsylvania, whereas in federal court, you don't need to file that certificate of merit. It's not essential to your claim. Do you see any difference between that and a notice requirement that is adopted under Pennsylvania law and there's a difference with the notice requirement and the procedure in federal law? Do you see any difference between the two of those?
Well, I don't think they match up four square. They're not exactly the same issue.
Right.
But applying the same analysis
really have
in
to
Ligon
do
Redding
with whether you have a claim in one court and you don't have a claim in another, whether you have a right in one court and you don't have a right in another. Isn't that what Ligon Redding was focused on?
That's correct. But since then, Pennsylvania Rules of Civil Procedure have found you have a right to be notified before that.
Pretty important right
to be notified before a judgment, in that case of non-pros, in this case of dismissal, can be taken against you. That right to receive notice is also a substantive right that affects the outcome of cases, including the incident.
Well, but outcome determinative, I mean, the court in Hanna said, you know, every procedural rule is outcome determinative, of course, because you could be thrown out. In fact, that was the issue in that case. But they said that doesn't matter. It's a federal rule, and we have the Congress has the right to enact federal rules. Isn't this really something that should be taken up by the local rules committees of the three districts in Pennsylvania and see whether they want to change the rule and what should it be? If you know, you file a motion to dismiss, then if someone files a certificate of merit after that, then you can't, the court can't grant a motion to dismiss? I mean, isn't this something that there should be notice and comment on?
I don't think so, because we're not talking about a new rule. There certainly wasn't notice and comment on importing the certificate of merit requirement in the first place. All we're saying is if you're going to import one and then the Pennsylvania rule changes, you have to import the other substantive rule too.
Judge Schmendel raises an interesting question, and one I had not considered, her last question. But my follow-up to that would be, might this be an appropriate subject for this court to exercise its authority to promulgate a supervisory rule? I haven't thought through this. It's only within the last 12 hours or so that it hit me, but it's, and I realize I lied. I said I'd shut up after my last question, but Judge Rendell's question prompts that.
It would make sense. I mean, the district courts are all over the map. One of the reasons
and
I think
it would
this
be possible
right.
that the district courts would continue to be all over the map if they adopted different rules
That's
rather
right.
than collective.
Which is why I think it urges this court to decide with finality here whether by advisory rulemaking, which I don't think is necessary but is one way to get there, or simply by finding, as the two Eastern District Courts cited in our brief already did, that it's appropriate to file a motion to dismiss if someone hasn't filed a certificate of merit. But where the certificate of merit is filed within 30 days of that motion, then the motion should just be denied and the case would proceed. And that best analogizes what the current state of the procedure is in Pennsylvania.
Right, procedure.
Right, so rules of civil procedure, Your Honor. That part is certainly a substantive rule in our opinion.
All right, we'll hear from you on rebuttal. Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. Kristen Pizeski on behalf of Dr. Uechel. Last name is P-I-E-S-E-S-K-I.
Ms. Pizeski, you would agree, would you not, that nowhere in his opinion did Judge Schwab discuss what I will refer to as the Pennsylvania COM rules regime as it exists post-2008?
He did not, Your Honor, and specifically he did not issue any type of comment on the notice issue, and that
did
is one of the reasons.
Parties urge that?
No.
Before him?
It is one of the reasons why we did
Well,
it was waived.
Wait
right?
a minute. You say it was waived, but it came up in a reply brief at the very least before the district court.
A sur-reply brief.
Which, frankly, I don't understand why it was characterized as a reply brief as it arose, but it was. It was filed, and I think Judge Schwab then ruled 24 hours later. But in any event, it was very clearly before the district court such that it can be raised here, was it not?
Judge Schwab chose not to evaluate the issue.
That's clear.
I think because he certainly accepted the answer as the primary brief, and although he granted leave to file a sur reply, an order that was not appealed, it was not addressed by him because it was raised substantively and briefed for the first time in that sur reply.
But even
certainly
the answer in paragraphs 19 and 20,
yes,
they denied your contention that this was merely procedural and was a rule that wouldn't apply in federal court?
Well, in general, yes, and said in rather vague terms, we'll address it later in our brief.
In the brief that was filed shortly thereafter, characterized as a sur reply.
Right. Yes, ma'am.
And in fact, after Judge Schwab had denied the plaintiff the right to file another submission, right?
Well, something that was formerly called a primary brief, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, whatever the hell you call it, there was still something filed that squarely put this question, this substantive question, before Judge Schwab, and he chose simply not to take it up.
He did not, and we did not have the opportunity either to address it for him so that he had both balanced views to look at before making a determination. And simply because he did not have that opportunity, nor did we, raised the issue of waiver. I understand the court's interest in the underlying issue and its importance, so I'm certainly prepared to address it on its merits.
Ms. Pisaski, what is wrong with looking at our adoption of Rule 104.2.3 as substantive law and the attendant remedy of dismissal that's embodied in 104.2.7 as including the conditions that Pennsylvania has provided for dismissal? Why isn't that part and parcel of the same substantive rule that we said we were adopting in requiring the COM?
Because it simply is procedural. It is not bound up in the substantive right, and I think there is a direct conflict here between Pennsylvania state law and the federal rules, and the federal rules should not acquiesce to or yield to the state rules on procedure. This is simply the form by which the remedy is occasioned.
It is not bound up in the substantive. Did we get it wrong in Liga and Reddy? I mean, I mean that truly. You don't get an opportunity to respond to questions like that very often when we're discussing what is clearly precedent of this court. But I ask it sincerely. Did we get it wrong in Liga and Reddy?
I don't think this precise question was before you, sir. We had a situation there where we were dealing with the issue of 41 and 7 and 1042.3, and we were discussing there the substantive nature of what the rule was trying to accomplish.
But we also what animated the ruling in Lake on Redding was the issue of forum shopping and avoiding inequitable administration of the law.
Yes, ma'am.
As in one state, you have to do something, you have to file a certificate of merit to have a claim, and in federal court, you did not. Isn't that a problem for forum shopping?
In this case, no.
Wasn't it in Ligon Redding?
Absolutely.
Okay.
But we don't have the same issue here.
Right.
To the contrary, I think plaintiff argues against that because plaintiffs would be more apt to file in state court.
Absolutely.
If they feel they get an extra layer of procedure which protects them against their own non-compliance.
The forum shopping problem may not be as blatant, but don't we still have a forum shopping problem in that in other cases it may be the defendant will remove on diversity grounds, recognizing that they have a different type of different conditions on dismissal in federal court than in state court, and act strategically. Indeed, I mean, your client here waited until after didn't accept service, waited until after 60 days. This was a very strategic decision around the intention to file a notice of dismissal. So we can't rule out forum shopping, and don't we have a pretty blatant problem in terms of the inequitable administration of the laws with a very different consequence in federal court and state court, one that Pennsylvania was trying to avoid with dismissals for lack of notice?
No, ma'am. Here in this case, Dr. Uchol was served May 9. The last seat to file the Certificate of Merit, May 19. Our duty under 12b-6 arguably expires May 27. So I are in a direct conflict there on a timing issue, one. But with respect to the forum shopping, it is the plaintiff who owns that decision. They make the decision, and that was the heart of the eerie concern about forum shopping.
Are you saying removal, vel known, does not present an opportunity for forum shopping by a defendant?
It would be extraordinarily rare for me to go to a client and counsel them that as a strategic move, one, I'm going to tell you, let's go through the cost and expense to remove it, simply to avoid a 30-day notice that's required as a matter of procedure under state law, and then to take it over here and file a motion to dismiss, which may be interpreted as notice anyway.
Because our statute of limitations is running.
When the statute of limitations is not expired, we go back. So
I fully agree with you in terms of probabilities, in terms of the incident. but...
I would suggest to the court it would never happen. My clients would not...
Then that's a different answer. I mean, probabilities and never, obviously, are two completely different quantities.
Ms. Podesky, you seem to accept that we could apply a doctrine of substantial compliance as a conceptual matter.
Certainly. I think so, because here I do believe there's a direct conflict. I don't think notice was required. I think the dismissal was appropriate. And in post-Womer, state and federal courts have looked to a substantial compliance.
But if notice is required, as I asked your adversary, you don't get to substantial compliance, do you? In this case.
If the court is going to construe, as Fabian and Moyer and plaintiff request, that now my motion to dismiss is notice, something which it is not, and reevaluates, reinterprets, and actually renames and repurposes the motion to dismiss, then in that case, Your Honor, would be correct. But I don't think that is the correct approach. It's not a Fabian approach.
Obviously, that's what I'm asking, that if plaintiff is correct, if Erie requires us to find that 1042.6, as it now exists, as a notice requirement is substantive law, then you don't reach the substantial compliance question. You just
don't
notice.
Okay. Because I didn't give him notice.
Right. But for us,
I don't think we get there.
To consider substantial compliance at all, don't we need to undertake an Erie analysis there? Or are you presuming that that is substantive law, something we can adopt from a general Pennsylvania rule, Rule 126? And how could it be that we would take that kind of protection from a general rule as substantive law that we're applying, but we wouldn't take the very specific, explicit protection that is built into the substantive COM requirement?
I think that the substantive compliance and equities is simply a construct for evaluating an equitable request to this court when there has been substantial compliance with rules.
By what authority? Because, I take Judge Krause's question to suggest that you seem to be arguing substantive implications to substantial compliance when it is actually an explicit creature of Pennsylvania procedural rules. And in fact, Chief Justice Cappy, in writing the Womer opinion, incorporated in that opinion reference to Rule 126, which is where the substantial compliance requirements reside. Obviously, if we cannot, per your argument, adopt 1042.6 as substantive law, I should think a fortiori we can't adopt Rule 126 as substantive law.
No, and I'm not asking the court to adopt
so
126.
So where do the substantial compliance rules come from? Federal law? Some federal common law? Some federal rule I've never heard of? Where do they come from?
Well, both this court and other states' courts, both this court, federal and state courts, have applied Womer as a construct to evaluate equitable remedy when it is requested, which is what this plaintiff is requesting.
In other words, to determine whether, indeed, a COM or the equivalent has been filed.
Correct. And I think that's the lesson to be learned from cases like Rogan, Booker, and others, it is a construct to be used for that purpose.
But that's a construct of state law.
Yeah.
And we have, in Chamberlain, in Nuveen, Newell, we accepted and applied the concept that New Jersey's equitable rule, I mean, there, New Jersey is not even built in as it is in Pennsylvania to a specific rule, but just a sort of equitable principle we adopted there and applied. If we've already done that as to certain protections that apply around a COM, why wouldn't we do that for a specific rule-based protection that's built into 104.2.6? 7, 104.2.6N7, which set forth certain conditions for dismissal.
I think the court is free to adopt an analysis to determine when its procedural rules are not followed. And so when we have here the procedural rules being followed by one party and not another, then this court may analyze that in the context of what rule is at issue. And what I am suggesting is that we have the roadmap to how to analyze those issues.
104.2.7 has some other conditions. For example, that dismissal can't be entered if there's a pending motion for determination that the filing of a certificate is not required.
Correct.
Is it your position that if someone's in federal court and they file that type of motion, that a motion to dismiss nonetheless can be granted within 60 days?
No, I certainly not. I think the court then has an issue to rule on, and in fact, that's what Justice Baer was, I think, most concentrated on in his
he was concerned about the snapping of judgments.
Right.
That was his concern.
He
pretty much got what he wanted with the amendment to the rule.
Right. And so, you know, we don't have that situation here where the other party is sitting in angst wondering, do I need a COM? And the defendant is hard-lined, yes, they're absolutely going to need one.
You file a motion and then you say, okay, extend the time period while I decide whether you need one.
Right. But there still has to be something done by the plaintiff. There is then something moved before the court to act on. And I would suggest in that scenario, it would be unfair for the court not to have the opportunity to rule on the issue of whether or not a COM is needed or not. But we don't have that here. We have a plaintiff who knew he needed one, who knew what the time was, who didn't need my notice, who did nothing to act, and that is non-compliance.
Well, from their argument, acted inadvertently, but that's exactly what 104.2.7A4 was meant to address.
No, I don't think that addresses inadvertence. I think it addresses a scenario where they're not sure.
Well, and it's also snap judgment. I mean, the null pros, you tiptoe into the prothonotary, you get a judgment.
Right.
I mean, that doesn't happen in federal court.
Correct.
Well, and I think Womer was a snap judgment. I think it was one day after the expiration of the 30 days, if I recall. But I'm not sure what that has to do with anything. I mean, following up again on Judge Crown's question, A4 affords this no less than 30 days for the filing of a precipice. Why?
No sooner than.
No less than 30 days. The precipice is filed no less than 30 days after the date of the filing of the notice of intention.
But the notice can't be filed until after 30 days of the filing of the complaint, not the service of the complaint.
But
correct.
The rules are going every which way.
Correct. But that's why there is a direct conflict.
Aren't we looking at dismissal and when dismissal is appropriate under the Pennsylvania rule? We've adopted the COM requirement, but the dismissal remedy that goes with that is also a creature of state law. That consequence is something that is in 104.2.7, and it is conditional with specific conditions that are spelled out in 104.2.7. Why would we adopt some of those conditions and not others?
The notice provision is simply procedural.
But we don't care how the notice is given. I mean, the notice could be by letter. It could be the fact of the motion to dismiss. It could be some formal notice that's filed. That is procedural. But the right to have the case dismissed as a result of failure to file the COM, that seems substantive, doesn't it?
The procedures or the mechanisms are not so closely bound up in the substantive right as to become substantive in and of themselves. And that is my position. If we now, take a motion to dismiss and turn it into something it is not, that belies this court's autonomy in its own federal rules.
Didn't Hannah, the court, Supreme Court in Hannah, say exactly that?
Yes, ma'am, and I do believe that is what Schmeigel is asking this court to do because of their reliance on Fabian and Moyer, the district court cases, where not only did the court interpret the motion to dismiss as the notice, but then the response to the motion to dismiss as something it wasn't, a request for an extension or a request for a ruling on whether or not a certificate of merit was required. Again, something that wasn't done within the time frame.
Irrespective of how we come out, we have to take on this question, although even though the district court did not, don't we? I mean, we have to confront the extension, well known, of Ligon Redding, if that's how one wants to call it. We have to reach whether or not, pursuant to Erie, we've got a substantive provision in new 1042.6 and 7, right?
Yeah, that goes back to the waiver argument. I believe you are correct. This court does need to address that issue.
And it would be of value to the district courts and to litigants, wouldn't it? Because we've got district courts that are going different ways.
It would be, and that's why the heart of my position today is not based on waiver and why I'm happy to discuss these issues. The only thing is, out of respect for Justice Schwab, who did not have the opportunity, nor did I below, I think waiver was an appropriate issue to bring before the court. Certainly appropriate time is now, and this is an appropriate case because, again, we have a scenario where even if we accept all that the plaintiff says is true, this case has great significance for Dr. Uecker because the statute of limitations is gone. And in some of those other cases where we were talking about there's no harm, no foul, that's not true here. So just as much as it is outcome determinative for him individually, this is going to send a very clear issue with regard to people who are in my position and advising our clients about the import of the statute of limitations. And when we follow the rules, what our federal court is going to do when we are doing what we are obligated to do. We are very clearly obligated now to file a motion to dismiss.
If he had filed within a year of the incident, we'd have no issue here.
We might not be here.
Because we wouldn't be.
We learned that if it's dismissed, it simply gets refiled. Yeah. That's why it's so critical here. Yeah. But here, the defendant's following your rules.
Right.
And those rules do not require a 30-day notice before I file my 12B6. And here, Dr. Uecker and I got our complaint, had to file a response within less than 20 days. So I am duty-bound to file my 12B6, and I don't have enough time to give him 30 days' notice. So there is a very real direct conflict in this case. So, yes, I agree. This is a very good case for this court to take on the issue of notice where there's clearly a direct conflict.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Buttle?
Thank you for your time and consideration, Your Honors. I'd like to take up two issues that came up during the last round of questioning. First of all, with respect to the question of forum shopping, I would advise that if it is indeed true that there is no notice requirement under the federal rules of procedure, then any defendant in Pennsylvania State Court who has the option to remove, if the statute of limitations has passed, would be well advised, rather than filing the 30-day notice and then giving an opportunity, to file for immediate removal, saying that 60 days has passed and thus that there is no opportunity to correct the certificate of merit situation. So,
if the statute of limitations has run.
Correct. It wouldn't be true in every case.
Yeah.
My client is not in the unique position of having filed a complaint relatively near the statute of limitations deadline.
It happens all the time.
That's right. It's not all of them, but it is a relatively common occurrence.
It may have been a galaxy far away, but as an old state court judge, it happened all the time. I know.
The forum shopping issue of creating an incentive for a defendant who, if he stays in state court, would be required to give another 30 days, or who could instead choose to remove and thus slam the door on that 30 days, is a real problem under an analysis under Erie and Ligon Redding. The other thing I'd like to address is specifically the question, I don't think this court got it wrong in Ligon Redding. At that time, this court tried to basically bring the entire certificate of merit regime to the extent possible into the federal courts.
This is something, though, you would concede that we need to wade into very, very carefully, especially when we are dealing with matter, with legal principles that the state system itself labels as procedural. They themselves consistently, in fact, I think I recall rumors referring to those rules that we have since adopted in Ligon Redding as being procedural.
It reminds me, Your Honor, of the phrase substantive due process, which taken a certain way sounds contradictory on its face, but is a thing certainly this court is familiar with dealing with. Yes, in some sense these are procedural rules.
You might find members of the Supreme Court of the United States to this day who would tell you that that's an oxymoron.
Correct, Your Honor. So, and this is similar in the sense that these are nominally procedural rules, that is, they're contained within the Pennsylvania Rules of Civil Procedure. But the analysis for determining for these purposes whether these are procedural or substantive is the three-pronged test set forth in Ligon Redding. And under that three-pronged test, it is clear that this particular circumstance, this particular new rule that wasn't on the table because it didn't exist yet in Ligon Redding, has to be part of the Certificate of Merit regime. If you're importing part of that into the federal court, which makes sense under that analysis, then you have to import all of the conditions, all of the requirements, and as nearly as possible the same procedures for obtaining a dismissal.
Let me ask a question. Erie has never been invoked to void a federal rule. You are really saying that the motion to dismiss is now a notice, correct?
No, not necessarily, Your Honor.
Oh, how does this work? I'm confused.
There's a lot of confusion among members of the bar, too, because it hasn't been articulated.
Well, but tell me how what we say is the rule here.
Well, so if there has not
been... Is there a motion to dismiss still permissible?
Yes, it is appropriate to file the motion to dismiss.
Okay, and what does that do?
That does one of two things. If prior notice has been given, then it may not be... Then you would raise that in the motion and say, hey, I gave 30 days notice, now I'm filing the motion. If no prior notice was given...
You can't give 30 days notice. You have to file the motion within 21 days of service.
Well, right, but you can choose to give notice sooner than that.
Well, nobody's going to do that.
You're saying that as a purely voluntary undertaking.
Correct.
That's not going to happen. If we can say people wait for the statute, that's not going to happen. Okay, so what do you do in 21 days when you have a right to file a motion to dismiss? You file a motion to dismiss.
If you file a motion to dismiss, then what that motion to dismiss does is... It is in and of itself sufficient. No subsequent filing on the part of the...
It doesn't say court, someone answer this and then court decide this motion. It doesn't work that way, does it?
It does, but what we have to do is we have to also open the door as part of that response to file a certificate of merit within 30 days. If that is the first notice that a plaintiff gets that there is no certificate of merit...
But that's not what the correct procedure is in federal court.
Well, there's no rule about that either way, Your Honor. I mean... It is clear, nothing in Rule 12 says if it's about certificates of merit, there has to be a 30-day notice period. That's a creature of Pennsylvania Rules of Civil Procedure, as is
You've
the certificate
already
of merit.
Said, have you not, that Rule 12 is the closest analog that
right.
you can find.
And so if we're in the world of analogs, the question is what's the closest analog to the substantive rule in Rule 1042.6? And our contention is that analog that was used by the Eastern District in two cases recently, which says if you file a certificate of merit within 30 days, we'll rule against the motion to dismiss. That's the closest procedural analog in this case.
Judge Rendell had raised earlier the Nuveen case in the New Jersey context, where we found under an Erie analysis that certain rules that were designed to... to give notice, to give protection to attorneys about the need for a certificate of merit were procedural and not substantive. How is what you're asking here distinguishable from Nuveen?
Well, there's a distinction, Your Honor, between rules about how notice is to be effectuated and rules as far as whether notice is to be effectuated.
But isn't the important thing what the requirements were? Nuveen dealt with a face sheet, a cover sheet, and a requirement that the court hold some kind of a conference, didn't it?
I know it dealt specifically with, you know, rules of New Jersey procedure that I am not particularly well acquainted with, but specifically New Jersey rules that had to do with the precise manner of filing things and not the substantive right that someone be put on notice. I also note that I think it's an important distinction that we've got an explicit rule of Pennsylvania civil procedure here saying you're entitled to this notice, that rule came into effect after Justice Baer's dissent and after concern was raised in the state court about the risk of snap judgments as a way to solve that problem. To me, that's an important distinguishing feature between the rule being considered here and the rule considered in...
Why isn't the motion to dismiss enough to satisfy what Justice Baer's concern was, i.e., against snap judgments?
Well, because if the defendants have their way, one day after the motion, we filed our certificate of merit.
But your statute of limitations had run.
True. But my position is simply when it says how does that affect snap judgments, they would have it such that once you file the Rule 12 motion to dismiss, I am now frozen in time. There, it might take the court 3 weeks to rule on the motion, but functionally, the day that motion is filed, the judgment is taken, because there is nothing I can do to file the certificate of merit after that date unless we impart some other way of understanding.
Well, if it was within 60 days, you could have. And if it was not up against the statute, then if the court was going to dismiss, you could refile, correct?
I mean, that's correct. There are other hypothetical situations in other cases that could be an out. Yes.
Right. Anything further? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The case is well argued. Take it under advisement.